Let's see. I think we're live on Facebook. Hi, everyone.
Hello, everybody. I hope you're having a fabulous Thursday over there. And I hope wherever you are, it is warm and lovely weather like Belma's about to go travel to.
Yes. Yes. I'm headed to San Diego right after our call, which I'm really excited about. So if there are any ladies from San Diego, definitely let me know. Say hi. But yeah, Lisa and I are so excited to be doing this call today. Hi, everyone. I feel like the ladies who are able to join, it's probably your lunchtime and you're probably, you know, on the East Coast. But either way, please say hi, give us a like, give us a heart. So just so you know, Lisa and I are calling in from Zoom, which means that there's a slight delay with Facebook. So if you see me like, you know, just switching direction a little bit, it's because I'm checking back and forth from the Zoom screen with Lisa to the Facebook group, because I really want to make sure that if you have any questions that, you know, we can answer those. So definitely please say hi, leave a comment, let us know if you're here, because I can't like directly see you. And yeah, I think we can get started. But you know, again, super excited to be here. One thing that I've been noticing in our community, which has been growing really nicely with so many amazing women, is that we have a ton of women in transition and women who are looking to get clear on their purpose or mission and also looking to, you know, feel more confident with your next steps. So if this is you, you're in the right place. And in case you're super new to the community and if we haven't connected one-on-one yet, I'm Belma McCaffrey. I am the CEO and founder of this platform. And everything that we do here is about challenging the status quo and redefining work. And you're going to hear me say that a lot because it's really what we're about. Our goal here is to make work a vehicle for creativity, change, and also living a better life, because we spent way too much time at work to not love it. And I feel so strongly too that the work we do has larger implications than we realize. And really now is the time for everyone to step up, tune into your passion, what it is that you want to do so that you can go out there and make an impact. So how do we do this? Well, we provide support in three ways. First, content. We have a ton of content on BelmaMcCaffrey.com, but we are working on launching a new platform in just a few weeks. Second is community. So as you see here, you're a part of the Work Bigger community now. We have a really safe space for women to come together. The goal is to make networking so much easier and to be able to facilitate introductions in a place where we have shared values. If you're anything like me, you probably find networking a little awkward sometimes. I know I always did, but I feel like, again, when you're in that safe space, it's so much easier to make those valuable connections. And the third piece is programming, which is where the amazing Lisa comes in. So we have an incredible team of coaches here at Work Bigger. And through our programming, we help you identify that mission or purpose and then execute on that purpose. So whether that means transitioning to a new job or launching your own business or starting a consulting company, whatever it is, so that you don't have to spin your wheels and wait years and years to do work that you love. Because I've been there and it is not fun. What else? So what are we talking about today? Today we're talking about the job search specifically. So you may have seen in the past couple of weeks, we've been hosting these Facebook Live events where we talk specifically about how to identify your mission, right? So that includes getting clear on your interests and your why, what it is that's driving you, identifying your strengths and where your skill set lies, and also what are your opportunity areas, what do you need to do to grow next? And then the other piece, your values. What do you stand for so that you can do work with integrity? Now we've jumped into the execution piece. On Tuesday, we talked about, with Erin, we talked about starting that business and what that could look like. And today we're focusing on the job search here with Lisa. And Lisa is one of our Work Bigger coaches. She has worked with hundreds of professionals on making a sustainable career change. And I want to stress the word sustainable, because that's really what it's about, right? It's not about putting a band-aid on the problem and finding that next job just to, you know, get by. It's really about long-term growth. So welcome, Lisa. I'm so excited that we're chatting here today.
Me too. Hi, Belma, and hi, everybody in the Work Bigger community. It is so exciting to get to be a part of this series of Facebook Lives where we get to have all kinds of good resources and juicy conversations about what you are needing and wanting most to help make the big, bold, brave transitions that you're wanting in life. So if you are watching and listening along from home, please drop us a little comment to say hey. And if you have any questions that we can address, part of this time and this conversation is designed to help you answer whatever it is that you're struggling with. So we'll dive in and cover a couple of the topics that we have on our to-do list that we think are super important to talk about. But if you have anything that is specific that you want us to address to, please don't hesitate to let us know.
Yes, absolutely. And hi, Kendall. I see that you're on. And again, hi, Leah. I'm doing like a quick refresh here and there because I want to make sure we capture all of your comments. So definitely let us know if you're here. Great. So Lisa, would love to start by having you share a little bit about your background. I know you have a really diverse work experience, which is amazing. So tell us about that and tell us about what you're doing now as a coach.
Totally, totally. Okay. And I hope that by sharing a little bit extra of my story than sort of how I usually tell the story of getting into coaching, that it can be really helpful in sort of seeing how one transition story can unfold over time. So I will try to keep it to the short-ish version, but if you looked at my life 5 years ago, I was working in digital marketing and I had been working my way up the ladder in Washington, D.C., doing grassroots activism and campaign work, and was in this big, high-flying, very sort of like fancy and shiny seeming from the outside kind of career. But I knew, being in it, that I was great at it, and it was work that I probably could do for years and years and years. But it just didn't feel like it had any integrity and any resonance and any fulfillment for me anymore. I knew I was capable of doing it, but there was this nagging part inside of my heart that said, this isn't for you. This isn't right. This isn't what you're meant to be doing for the rest of your career. And it was so distressing and so overwhelming to feel that way because, you know, I was totally like type A, high achiever, perfectionist, like always like doing everything exactly by the book, making everybody else really impressed. And I had hit this point where I realized I was so busy doing the things that were impressive and exciting and interesting to everybody else that I had forsaken and forgotten about what mattered most for me. So for me, over the past 5 years, it has been a journey into figuring out what work, what way of serving, what way of contributing to the world, to the economy, to the community, to each individual person that I interact with day to day feels the most exciting and valuable for me. But to give you a brief period or a brief story of what happened in the past 5 years, when I first had that realization of, oh my gosh, this is not for me and I don't know what to do, the if not this, then what moment, my first thought was, you know, I was working with a therapist who I loved. And she and I were chatting and I was talking through this existential crisis that I was feeling. And I had this moment that came on where I thought, you know, I love having one-on-one conversations with people around really difficult topics. And when I looked at my career and what I had been doing previously, I had been in this marketing and branding world. And what I ended up doing with my free time and my spare time for fun was having conversations with people about their own personal brands. And about career pathing and about how they wanted to present themselves and the way to say the difficult things that they had been wanting to say. And so when I was feeling like I wasn't fulfilled in marketing, my first thought was, I should go become a therapist because therapists get to work one-on-one with people, have these hard conversations. It'll be awesome. Let me make it happen. So I started running in that direction and took the GRE, applied to grad school, found these different programs where I could do grad school part-time, keep working full-time, and then ease my way into transition. And I got into grad school and I was 24 hours out from starting my master's in clinical mental health counseling when I had this little voice in the back of my head say, are you sure this is what you want to be doing? And back when I was in college, I had been an economics major. So managing risk and feeling like you have dealt with the uncertainty in front of you has always been a big focus for me. And I thought, you know what? I'm just not 100% sure that this is for me. So I decided to do a test drive of counseling by becoming an online text counselor with Crisis Text Line. Mm-hmm. And while I loved the volunteer work and I loved doing that, what I realized from trying this out and doing this little pilot program for myself was that I couldn't do that 40 hours a week. It wasn't wired and wasn't built in such a way that I could be that support and be that rock for people in that kind of a way. So I had a panic, as one does when you are in a moment of transition saying, oh my gosh, this is my plan A. It's not going to work. What do I do? And so for me, that's when I enlisted my own career coach and started working through peeling apart what it was that I was really loving in my job. And what I realized was that I loved working one-on-one with people, talking about personal branding, talking about resumes, talking about interviewing, and that there was a career path to do exactly that and make that a bigger part of what my life was. So back in 2015, I started a little side coaching business just to see if anybody would pay me for help with resume stuff, interview stuff, all those little granular pieces. And over the past 2.5 years, I have gotten a career coaching certification in the Pivot Method, which is all about making transitions in the safest way possible and using all the tools in your toolbox, and was able to go from doing this little side business while I had my 9-to-5 job to eventually turning that side business into my full business. So it has been awesome getting to sort of be the proof of the process in my own path, and then getting to meet amazing people like Belma, like the other coaches in the Work Bigger community who have been handpicked, and they are so good and they are so intuitive and insightful and thoughtful and wonderful, wonderful people. And to get to be a part of this journey with all of you right now. So that is my own transition up and down narrative saga and how I got to be here.
I love it. Lisa, and I bet you so many women too in our community could relate to that, because also like going back to grad school and then realizing like, oh my God, this isn't really what I want to do. That must have been really scary. There are so many people who are in that position, right? Can you?
It is really scary because grad school can feel so safe and so clear sometimes. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, as we are going through school, you have all these check boxes of, you know, my job is to get my best grades in this class in this semester and then get to the next semester and then to graduate and then get on to college and then to do really well in those. And then it's like after you've graduated from college, all of those check boxes about what's next sort of start to disappear. Mm-hmm. Like friends and family and forces in your life might say, you know, getting married or getting a specific type of job or making a certain amount of money or living in a certain way become the new check boxes for you. But you have such an opportunity to write your own checkboxes and next steps that it can feel both exhilarating and terrifying. And in that way, grad school can feel like it is managing some of that terror and creating that structure again. But the most challenging, most painful thing can be for folks who went to grad school with the expectation that it was going to solve a certain question for them around their career. And then they graduate and they realize, oh my gosh, I'm still stuck with not knowing exactly the types of things that feel really good for me to do. And now I'm feeling this extra pressure because I have this extra student loan debt on my shoulder and on my head. So if you're thinking about grad school, it can absolutely be the right decision for some people to be, you know, the key that you need to unlock the next step in your career. So for example, if I had decided that counseling was definitely for me, you really can't go do that in a licensed clinical capacity without your master's. So in that case, grad school would have been 100% the right way to move. But if you're feeling questions and uncertainty about, is this going to be the right move for me? Am I sure that this is what I need? There are tons of different ways that you can do some test driving and manage some of that risk, manage some of the uncertainty beforehand so that you can feel super comfortable and confident enrolling in grad school or opening up all kinds of new possibilities for ways to bring the parts of you that you love and enjoy the most into the work world in ways beyond what you might have initially known were possible.
Yeah. I've talked about this so many times. So one of the inspirations for Work Bigger was for me going back to grad school because I made that same decision. Like I started to feel in my mid-20s that entrepreneurship was something that felt right, but I didn't know, like I wasn't 100% sure. And first of all, you don't need to go get an MBA if you want to be an entrepreneur. I actually would not necessarily recommend it. And I went to business school and I saw while I was there that 95% of my colleagues, everyone was like, business school is our do-over. This is our second chance to figure things out. And I really feel like it's putting a band-aid on the problem because you don't really know if it's in business school or grad school, like whatever it is, you're not really getting into the personal development piece. You're not really digging deep on what matters to you and who you are. And that's the foundation of figuring out what you want to do, right?
Yeah, so true. Which, I mean, Belma, like to your credit, is one of the reasons why Work Bigger and the program and the curriculum and the resources and the thoughtfulness that are in it are so amazing. Because nobody gets a class in school that says, how do you figure out your values, your gifts, your personality quirks, your needs, and then synthesize that all together in a way that's going to bring you joy in the workplace. Mm-hmm. And it's such a shame that there's not a class like that that's out there. And it's so amazing that you, throughout your experience, throughout the things that you witnessed in business school, in your own career path, were able to pull together all these different things to make essentially the cheat sheet for how to do this in a way that is not going to make you feel like you are jumping from job to job to job, bringing your same baggage and your same frustrations and your same angst with you, but actually learning how to work with what makes you unique, what makes you you, what makes you shine and tick and feel like you're the most alive.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for saying that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Lisa. That means a lot. And I want to talk now a little bit about the pivot method. So I love that you touched on that. And I feel like that is especially important when you're in that transition phase. So can you talk at a high level about what that is?
Totally, totally. So the pivot method is a methodology coined by Jenny Blake, who is another fabulous career coach, who started her career doing coaching at Google and then left to go out on her own to do her own thing probably, 7 years ago at this point. But what she was noticing was that she was based in Silicon Valley, and what you would hear about were all of these startups that had to do a pivot, which was effectively when their plan A business model was not allowing them to create the profitability, capture the market opportunity, whatever it was in front of them. And what they had to do was figure out what their existing assets and resources were, what they were able to best leverage, and then utilize that to make a shift in their strategy and a shift in their direction, their investment, their energy, their resources, etc., to better make the turn in profitability. And she thought, you know, there's a lot of merit in thinking about our own personal paths through this same lens of how do I leverage what's working to figure out what's next. So she designed a methodology that looks very similar to a lot of the things that are within Work Bigger. That's essentially at the 30,000 foot level based on these principles. Number one, figure out what is working for you. She calls this the plant phase, where you are grounding yourself firmly in what you love, what you have seen in the past brings you joy and fulfillment and success, what you know you need, what you value. Because one of the things that I think really causes these moments of transition and change in our life is that we've evolved and that we might be attaching ourselves to a past version of us and what that past version needed, wanted, etc. But the current version of us has very different needs. And that can happen when you have gotten married or when you have bought a piece of property or when you've had your first kiddo or when you have gone on a trip that opened up your mind and your eyes to something completely new that you didn't know about yourself, or when you've taken a class that all of a sudden made you realize that you love something, or when you had a breakup that made you realize that you have these values that are so critical to you. So planting yourself in who you are right now, what matters most to you, is the most helpful foundational groundwork that you can lay for yourself to figure out what's coming next. So you start and plant.
Love that. Yeah. Go ahead. Sorry.
So from here,
I love it. Keep going.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's preaching to the choir with all the great work that you do and what you've created. So, but then from there, obviously knowing just what you need is not enough, right? Because there is a Venn diagram overlap between what you need and want and what the market needs and wants. And so you have to try to find that teeny tiny spot in there where the two of them come together. So the next part of the process is scanning, which is where you then turn that sort of flashlight that was pointed in towards you outward towards the marketplace to say, what's available? What are some of the different jobs that are out there? What are some of the ways in which I might be able to get my needs met in a new sector, a new role, a new industry, a new, you know, conception of what I used to think of as what's possible for me in work that could be really fun and fulfilling? So this phase is all about doing research, talking to people, reading things, you know, really digging deeply to see what's out there and see what's possible.
Exploring, right? And yes, broadening your scope of options. Because sometimes I think that we feel so limited with what's out there because we don't know, like you said it's like first tuning into what you want and then going out there. And that's when I feel like you realize there are so many more options than we think there are, especially today with the workplace.
Totally. Well, and Belma, you're bringing up something really important, which is that if this is something that you could solve, knowing the current options that you have available, Like, that's possible, but it's also possible that there are options beyond what you already know about that could be an amazing fit for you. So part of this second stage, the scanning stage and this exploration stage, is about intentionally being vulnerable and asking people for new ideas and seeking out new possibilities and potential. Mm-hmm. And it rolls really nicely into the third stage of her process, which is called pilot, which is where you get out there and you try something that you think could be a really good fit. Because the idea of something and being in love with the dream of becoming a therapist, I found out was very different from the reality of becoming a therapist. And checking to make sure that the dream and the reality matched saved me tens of thousands, maybe even hundreds of thousands of dollars of loan debt and years of my life studying something that ultimately wasn't going to point me in the direction that felt really right for me. So finding ways that you can then try something on and see how it fits you is super important and will usually give you some transferable experiences that you can then put on your resume and use to show off how this actually isn't that much of a pivot for you because you've already got some experience in the field. And similarly, piloting new things will usually require you to make new contacts and generate strategic relationships with people who work in the type of work that you want to do. And those relationships will also make the process of making the full transition even easier.
Yeah, you're touching on a lot of the stuff that that I actually want to talk about today. Can you share with me, because I know you've coached a lot of women, what do you see as the biggest challenge or pain that the, you know, women who are in that career transition, they're looking for that, you know, ideal job. What do you see as like the biggest pain, like their biggest struggle?
Well, if I can offer up two things, I see two things as being the biggest issues, the biggest challenges. Number one is when you have a secret dream for what you have been wanting to be doing, but you feel like you haven't been able to give yourself permission to do it, either because there are other people in your life who have been saying, oh, you can't do that. You could never do that. You couldn't handle the risk of being an entrepreneur, blah, blah, blah. And so that pain point is learning how to trust yourself, believe in yourself, but also be really strategic and savvy and set yourself up for success with a plan to manage that risk, manage those fears and worries to make it a reality for yourself. So that's pain point number one. Pain point number two that I tend to see from sort of like the other half of folks is that, and I imagine you probably see a ton of this too, that when you work with a certain type of high performing, high achieving, very smart, very talented, very ambitious, has been very successful in the past kind of woman, she tends to put so much pressure on herself and has this idea that there is one right job for me out there somewhere. And number one, I'm defective right now because I'm in a job that is not that one right job and I haven't found it. So there's like a shame blame game that's going on. And then number two, it's almost this like Cinderella glass slipper sort of mentality of, I just need to find that one thing and that one right thing will be there and everything else besides that one right thing is the wrong thing. And that kind of a mental model and a mindset for how to approach the job search can create so much pain because for women who are high performing, high achieving, there's probably not one right thing for you because you learn and grow and evolve so fast that even if you found a job that was amazing for you and fit all of your criteria and your needs right now, I would guarantee you that 18 months from now, there's going to be a part of you that's like, ugh, like this has been good, but I want to move on to the next thing. And if you have this mindset of shame, blame, that if I'm not in the right thing, it's the wrong thing, then it's going to cause so much pain and frustration and suffering. But if you have the mindset of, you know, I am a dynamic, growing, evolving human being, and I'm expecting to be in this position and grow and learn everything that I can and have a lot of fun with it, and then get the opportunity to grow into something new, you know, to outgrow this and grow into something, then all of a sudden, you're having the exact same lived experience, but it feels different. It feels empowering and exciting and energizing to be looking out there into the horizon to say, how do I take what's working for me and figure out what would be really fun for me to move into for this next chapter, as opposed to, oh, I went into this job, it looks so perfect, but I didn't know this thing, and now that makes me upset, and I have failed. Mm-hmm. So it is either the permission or the perfectionistic pressure that cause the two biggest frustrations and issues and tensions, and also can open up the most amazing possibilities for you.
Yeah, I mean, the first thing that you hit on, like giving ourselves the permission to go out and commit to and do what it is, that's the scariest thing. And I feel like that takes a lot of work, and also looking inward on what's really holding you back. Like, why is that a problem for you? I mean, it happens to all of us, right? So I think you're like right on the money with that answer. And then two, like what you're hitting on, it's so true. Like, especially if you're a high achieving woman, like you constantly want to be growing, but accepting and understanding that that's a good thing. Like, that is a gift. Your need for growth and a constant challenge, that's amazing. It's not something to be ashamed of. So I love how you reframe that, because I think when you talk about it from that perspective, you realize that it's really coming from a more empowered place versus, you know, the scarcity mindset, or the I'm going to beat myself up because I haven't, you know, haven't figured out all my shit yet mindset. So yeah, I'm going to check in real quick because I see some comments coming in. Hi, Stephanie. So happy to see you here. I think Lori's here as well. So yeah, I would love to hear, is any of this resonating with you ladies? Like, what resonates the most? Hi, Mickey. Good to see you. Leah says, speaking to my soul sister, I wish I didn't have this 1:30 meeting. No worries. I know. I feel like Lisa and I can actually talk for hours, and I also have to catch a plane, which is kind of a bummer. Stephanie says, oh my gosh, this is exactly what my last 4 weeks have been. I love it. Hi, Kindle. Yeah, so since we only have a couple of minutes left, I'm super bummed actually, because I would love to chat more. I have two more questions for you, Lisa. One, again, ladies, like, please definitely feel free. If you can't catch this live, definitely share a question after. Lisa and I will be here right in the community, so we can always follow up with you. But the transferable experiences, that's another thing that I hear all the time as a pain point. And I shared an article in yesterday in the blog, and actually it's linked here, so please do read that article. I go into detail about how to make your skills more transferable to that new industry or that new job, and there's also a workbook. I love giving you workbooks and homework, so please download that and sit with those questions, because this is some of the stuff that you need to figure out as you're making your transition. But Lisa, any tips or suggestions, and this is a little bit broad so we can, you know, talk about it more, but how does someone make their skills a little bit more transferable when they're coming from a completely different industry and they want to do something really different? It's pretty overwhelming and difficult. So any tips that you have on that?
Totally, totally. Oh, it's such a good question, and it is such a pain point. But so here's an analogy that I hope resonates. So imagine that you are looking at a like fabulous chocolate cake in front of you, and you're looking at it and you're thinking, you know, this is a chocolate cake. It is not a strawberry cake. It is not a vanilla cake. This is distinctly a chocolate cake. If you back yourself up to what that cake was 2 hours ago, it was a counter full of ingredients. You had eggs, you had sugar, you had flour. And in fact, almost the only thing that is differentiating a chocolate cake from any other cake is the addition of cocoa powder. If you look at all the raw ingredients that go into making that output, making that thing, they're actually really, really similar and could help you to make a whole bunch of different things. I mean, you could make pancakes with eggs and flour and sugar. You could make a vanilla cake. You could make cupcakes. And I think that if you use that same model for peeling apart the inputs that go into any of the outputs you've created within your work, you might find some really interesting and surprising common threads. Because think about the flavor of the cake as essentially being the sector or the industry that you're working in, or even the role in which you're doing this work. You know, there are needs for people who are great at organizing projects and programs in every single industry, and probably in almost every single role that you'll be working in. You know, there's a need for people who are amazing communicators and who are great writers in almost every single company that's out there. So if you can think of yourself as the raw materials as the eggs, as the sugar, as the flour, as the vanilla extract, you know, all those things, and help to essentially create the picture for the hiring manager about how those things could be recombined in a new and different way, then it'll actually make the process of pulling out, identifying, and then highlighting your transferable skills way easier than it might feel like or might seem on its place or on its face. So think about what the inputs are that make you able to be so successful. And not only are you probably going to get down to what your strengths and your gifts are, but you're also going to make it super easy to match up what you're capable of doing with what a job description is asking you for by just recombining those ingredients in new and different ways.
I love that. I've never heard that analogy before, and I think it makes perfect sense. So I don't have any follow-up to that. I just
Well, I hope it's not making people too hungry for cupcakes. I know that lunch breaks are probably over or just starting for folks.
No, I love it. The last question I have for you, and then, I'm so sad we have to wrap up, but tell me, what advice do you have for all the women in our community who are feeling really stuck or frustrated right now? Like what, you know, just how can they get through this difficult phase, which can be really stressful?
This is such a good question. And it's such a real experience that if you are in the middle of a transition and you're in a job that you don't like, and that is not filling you up, it probably feels like it's draining you. And it probably feels like you just can't find the margin and the extra time and the extra energy in your life. And so the two pieces of advice I have for you are, number one, ask yourself, what do I need to stop doing so I can do what matters most? And for you, if that means I need to set better boundaries with work where I'm leaving at 5:30 no matter what, because I don't want to be in this job forever, then that's hard and uncomfortable, and it's probably exactly what you need. If the answer is I need to, you know, take a hiatus from my choir, or from my dance team, or from my book club to free up a little bit more time and space and rest, then maybe in this season, that's exactly what you need just to get that little bit more energy and that little bit more margin in your life. So number one, ask yourself, what do I need to stop doing so I can do what matters most? And then number two, oh gosh, Bellman, I can't remember what my number two was.
That's okay.
Number one is probably certainly enough on its own.
Yeah. And I feel like that's another thing that can be so difficult. But the thing that comes to mind for me, and I can speak personal experience, making the decision for me, I remember to cut back to part-time at the Associated Press, where I used to work full-time. I transitioned to a part-time role in business development. And there were so many fears around that. How are they going to perceive me? Am I going to lose my job? Like, what's going to happen? As a woman, I think it was especially difficult because I was a new mom. So that was a whole other concern in and of itself, in terms of like, how is my employer going to perceive me? Are they all of a sudden just going to think whatever it is that I think, you know, new moms are dealing with, which is a different conversation. But I had a lot of fears around that. And I remember having to commit to cutting back to part-time and having that difficult, extremely uncomfortable conversation, because for me, bringing work bigger to life was that important, where it was worth it, right? So when you share that experience, figuring out what do you need to cut back to be able to make this change, that does mean, I think, making those difficult decisions, which are the right decisions. They may feel difficult, right? Because we may not like saying no or whatever. It's tapping into some sort of insecurity, whatever it is that we have, but it is the right decision. And eventually that becomes a lot easier to do. So.
Yeah. Oh, and you just reminded me of what my second piece of advice was, which is that you have an abundant amount of choice in your life. You are the boss of your own life, and you get to be the final authority and the final say about what's going to feel good and feel right for you. So don't forget that in any situation you're in, work-wise, life-wise, et cetera, that you have choices. You have choices about whether or not you tolerate being there. You have choices about how you interpret what is happening. You have choices about how much rest and self-care you do. So feeling as empowered as possible to make the best choices for you and to be the boss of your own life and not let anybody else tell you how it has to be can be a huge way to gain back some of that energy and that sense of power and authority and forward momentum in figuring out what's going to be next for you.
Yeah. I love it. Thank you so much, Lisa. I'm so sad, everyone, that we're out of time. I'm going to check Facebook once more because I do see your comments and your likes. Give us a heart. Hi, Lori. She says, great analogy for transferable skills. I totally agree. Thank you so much for joining live. Ladies, let us know what has resonated with you most during this call. What other questions do you have for us? There's absolutely no pressure. Like, if questions come to you later, just pop it in the comments and share with us. Lisa and I are going to be here. But yeah, Lisa, thank you so much for your time. I always have so much fun chatting with you, and it's amazing to be working with you.
Likewise, it has been so great to be part of Team Work Bigger, and I can't wait to help more people change work.
Yes. And ladies, one last note. We have a big announcement coming up next week, so please keep an eye out for that. Super excited to share it with you. And again, thank you. Thank you, Lisa and everyone. Checking once more. But yeah, that's it. Feel free to follow up anytime. And thanks again, everyone. Bye.
Bye.